This is the very edge of Europe. A remote place, battered by the Atlantic Ocean. A land of rain and wind. And home to the Celts. You could be forgiven for thinking that I was in Scotland or Ireland, but in actual fact, I'm in northwest Spain, in Galicia, a place that's rightfully proud of its Celtic identity. And I have to say, I've always felt right at home here. The Galicians have fallen madly in love with the music I love, the music of Scotland and Ireland. But I'm really convinced that there's a beautiful, exciting musical connection between all these Celtic nations. It doesn't matter if you're in Galicia or Galicia, they're connected. And when it comes to Celtic music, the old squeeze box generally has something to say about it. I've come to Santiago de Compostela, the capital of Galicia, and for centuries, one of the most important places of pilgrimage in the Christian world. It's a city shaped by travellers. Something that's very apparent in the heart of the old town. This, the main street, is called Rua do Franco, after the many French pilgrims who arrived here. But this street is certainly not named after General Franco. He was Galician, but as leader of Spain, he crushed Galician culture. To say that he's not liked around here is a bit of an understatement. He's hated. Franco's murderous reign ended in 1975, after four decades of fascist dictatorship. It was a generation of cultural oppression. But Franco's death actually resulted in something that he would have loathed. A massive revival in Galician culture and a celebration of its Celtic roots. And right at the heart of the celebration was music. I've come to Santiago to meet someone with a very strong and very personal connection to that revival in Galician music. Sadly, he's not an accordion player. He plays the gaita, the bagpipes. His name is Carlos Nunez, and I think he's trying to get me lifted.
He's very dangerous. He's a great musician.
How you doing, man?
You trying to get me arrested?
Hello, Phil Cunningham.
Oh, nice to see you, Carlos.
Oh, welcome to Santiago.
Carlos is a truly world-class musician. His talents were recognised by the chieftains, the great-grandfathers of Celtic folk music. For a time, this young Galician was known as the seventh member of a very Irish band. Carlos is also a genuine scholar of Celtic culture, well aware of the long-standing links between his fellow Galicians and the Celts of Northern Europe.
We speak about Celtic music since centuries ago. You know, in the 19th century, there were great people thinking about that. No, even copying and following the Scottish dream. No, always the music. It was very important in that Celtic wave. No, the music. I will say it was the most important thing.
But the music of Galicia and the other Spanish regions was threatened by General Franco. The dictator was convinced that the music of southern Spain, particularly the flamenco, would be more appealing to the foreign visitor.
He knew that the flamenco was very touristic, you know? So he found that the south, it was more the image, the international image. Galicia is like another country, no? Very different than the flamenco.
How did people manage to keep the music alive during this time? Did they have to go underground?
Yeah, you know, here people are very brave, like Scottish people. And even with Franco, with the dictators, people will still with the old traditions. It's something that is inside us, the pipes, the gaita. We'll be right back.
we were talking a little bit about Franco there and how people kept music alive, but a lot of people were persecuted in Galicia, your own father included. He was in prison. You taught me a piece of music called Maria Soligna, and your father learned that in prison?
Yes, he was a colleague in prison with the poet that...
A cellmate, yeah.
Yes, that wrote this poem. Celso Emilio Ferreiro is his name. Yeah, my father, he helped him to write this.
To transcribe it.
Yes, so when I came with the music and I played for my father, I learned that music from another composer, he was, a moment of emotion. At that time, in the 60s, in the 70s, traditions, Celtic music, it means freedom. Even for people here, still this connection, no, between freedom, the possibility of dream without...
The right to express
exactly
yourself through your own music.
Exactly.
It really is a beautiful piece of music, and it's a fitting tribute to the many Galicians who suffered under Franco. But the revival in Galician culture that emerged from those dark days, well, Carlos insists it's still growing. Celtic music may well be expanding, but what is there in being Celtic that brings these parts of Europe closer together? Why is it that these ancient warrior tribes, driven to the fringes of Europe, have such a relevance to our music today? I've been asked a lot of times what I think being Celtic is. I'm not very sure is the honest answer. We seem to have a lot of things in common. I don't know if it's the sense of passion that we have, the sense of romanticism that we have, the sense of adventure, the sense of humour. You know, there's something that binds us together and ties us together. And for me, I notice it most of all musically. And I can sit down with a musician from here and start playing tunes, even tunes I've never played in my life before. I began on the Galician coast, just to the west of Santiago, and I'm finishing here on the Connemara coast, just to the west of Galway. And if I've learned one thing on my travels, it's that Celtic music has become so much more than music alone. It's developed into a real symbol of identity, something that can really help to hold a small community together. And of course, the best part of the whole thing has been discovering how my own instrument has played such an important part all across the music of Celtic Europe. I love the fact that the accordion's managed to squeeze its way into their respective cultures, and I particularly love the fact that it's become a valid and valued part of their Celtic identities. That's quite an achievement for one instrument, and definitely something to tell the folks back home.
Swapping traditions for a new way of life, but will it be as they hope for? Leaving Amish Paradise next on BBC Two Scotland.